enter into your gates with thanksgiving. Lord, we enter into your courts with praise. Lord, we enter into your gates with thanksgiving. Lord, we enter into your courts with praise. Lord, we enter into your gates with thanksgiving. Lord, we enter into your courts with praise. depths of my being I see. The depths of my being I see. The depths of my being I see. The depths of my being I say. The depths of my being I say. The depths of my being I say. Your grace, oh Lord. Oh Lord, you are high. To be feared by all. We adore. We adore. Oh, beautiful, beautiful. Oh, beautiful, beautiful. Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Oh, wonderful. So beautiful, beautiful. So beautiful, beautiful. You're so wonderful, wonderful. You're so wonderful, wonderful. You're so beautiful, beautiful, Lord. You're so beautiful, beautiful, Lord. You're so wonderful, wonderful, Lord. You're so wonderful, wonderful, Lord. You're so beautiful, beautiful, Lord. You're so beautiful, beautiful, Lord. You're so wonderful, wonderful, Lord. You're so wonderful, wonderful, Lord. And my soul praises you. and your people that praise you too. We praise you, Lord. With all our might, with all our strength, with all our breath, with all our being.
Oh, beautiful, beautiful. Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Oh, wonderful, wonderful love. Oh, beautiful, beautiful. Beautiful, beautiful.
Declare your glory. day, us to breathe or say, the peace is a praise, all the wholeness of praise, all the fruits of praise. I can see it now, 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 I can see it now. Clap your hands, all you people. Oh, we bring our best to you, Lord. Bring our everything to you, Lord. Oh, we bring our everything. Ain't gonna let the heathens praise be louder. Gonna let the heathens praise be louder and our. Oh, praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Oh, we say praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Anymore. Get a glimpse of heaven and your soul will sing beautiful. You are. Your soul will say, I want to live in this realm always. Your soul will say, I will not have it any other way. The line is drawn. The line is delineated in front of me. The line is there. I know the boundaries of heaven. And within those boundaries, I will stay. I will stay. Say, I will stay. Lord, I will stay. Lord, I will be all you want me to. Oh, I will be all you want me to. Lord, I will be. All you want me to.
All you want me to.
Find here hunger and thirst and passion, Lord. Find here hunger and thirst and passion, Lord. Find here hunger and thirst and passion. Find here such hunger, thirst, and passion for you. Only for you. Only for you, Lord. Oh, only for you. Oh, only for you. Oh, only for you. Only for you. Oh, the glory of your presence, Lord. Oh, the beauty and the splendor of your righteousness. Your justice and judgment beyond compare. Your mercy, graciousness, and compassion unfailing beyond compare. There is none like you, Lord. 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 Mighty, merciful, everlasting compassion and gracious, long-suffering beyond anything we could ever know. Your love so deep, so rich, so wide, that you say to us, come draw nigh, come near to me. I want to be with you. Oh, Lord, surely my heart says, I will seek you. I will be near to you. Draw me close. Closer still. Closer still. Closer still. Closer still. Closer still. In your mercy, Lord, we bring the hearts of everyone here before you. In your mercy, Lord, I bring the hearts of everyone here before you. In your mercy, God. In your mercy, Lord, reveal yourself. In your mercy, Lord, reveal yourself. Glory cloud of heaven, fire the Spirit, baptize afresh now, baptize anew, fill with more of you, fill with more of you, fill with more of you, Jesus, more of you, Holy Ghost. More of you, Father. There's none like you, Lord. There's none like you, Lord. There is none like you. There is none like you, Lord. Unmatchable sovereign. Incredible awesome. You whose glory outshines the sun. That lights up all heaven, that there be no light other than yours. There need be no lamp, no fire but yours. None but your glory, and we get to live in that forever, for eternity with you, Lord. Oh, may the reality of eternity strike our hearts, Lord. Oh, may the reality of eternity strike our hearts, Lord. That this joyous communion and fellowship we have with you, oh God, for all eternity to dwell in you, to dwell in your presence, to dwell in your presence, to dwell in the house of the Lord, to get to spend forever with you, Lord, lover of our soul. Lover of our soul, you who loves us more than anyone, You who loves us far more beyond we could ever imagine, think or ask. There is none like you. Singing this with me just for another couple times. There is none like you. There is none like you. And your presence is so sacred to us, God. Well, there is none like you. As testified countless times by men in Scripture, there is none like you. In times past, all the way through, you've shown yourself that there is none like you. Lord, there is none like you. Oh Lord, there is none. Testify throughout eternity, Lord, that there is none like you. Truly, Lord, there is none you, Lord. There is none like you. Forever I will live in this reality. There is none like you. There is none like you. There is none like you. presence so sweet, Lord. We will never take for granted what you've given. Oh, the mantle upon this place. Oh, the grace. Oh, the grace upon the abiding place. Nation turn, nations turn because of the people of God. They gather themselves together at the abiding place. The place declared to be those who abide in you. Those who abide here in this abiding place. Just sing it once more before Pastor Geneva comes. Oh, there is no like you.
There's none like you, Lord Jesus. There's none like you, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, we worship you and we praise you. We thank you, Father, for the gift of your Son. We thank you that you loved us so much. You loved us so much even when we were in our sin and we were in iniquity and we were the servants of sin. Christ died for us. For the ungodly, and only by your love and only by the grace of Jesus Christ. Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah!
Only by your blood and only by your mercy and your grace, oh God, could we be made one with you. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, it is too much for us to comprehend. It's too much for us to even understand. Because it's Alpha and Omega, beginning and end. It's eternal. It's who you are. But Father, we freely receive this free gift. Woo, glory! And all that you have done for us. And Lord, I pray that we count what you have done so dear. Father, that we fulfill all that you have planned for us to walk out. Yes. Father, that we count it so dear.
Yes, Lord.
That we count, Father, what you've done for us so dear.
Yes.
That we will not let one thing slip. Oh God, that we will not let one thing slip. Not one thing. We will not let one thing slip. Jesus. We will not be careless, oh God, with the salvation that you have given us. But we, through the Spirit and by the Spirit that you have so freely given us, will fulfill all that you called us to do. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Whoo, because there's none like you, Lord. There's none like you, Lord Jesus. Father, I thank you that your spirit is life, that you are spirit, and the spirit is life. And by the spirit and through the spirit, we can comprehend the things of the spirit because you reveal them to us by your spirit. Oh, Lord Jesus. And we pray, Father, as your word goes forth this morning, by the Spirit and through the Spirit, it will pierce every heart, Lord, and take us deeper. Take us deeper in the realms of your presence and the realms of your glory, that we will not walk any longer as men, as mere men, but we will realize what you have done for us. And Lord, for many in this place, that our life would cease and desist, and we would be dead and buried and raised up together in you. Realize, Father, what you have done and walk it out, live it. Father, we don't want to sit in a place that speaks your word so purely and so boldly and go to hell or be careless with this glorious, precious gift that you have given us. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus, that there is none like you. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, I thank you that I just yield myself up to you again this morning, again and again and again. Lord, and I thank you that you formed the mouth. You made these lips, and Lord, you speak through them because I surrender it all to you. And I don't want to say anything of myself, oh God. But I only want to speak by your spirit. For Father, that is where we are to live, and that's all that we are to be, is people of the spirit. For this is the work that you have done through Christ Jesus, to bring us up, to seat us in heavenly places before you. Whoo, hallelujah. To make us heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ the righteous. Oh, Lord, you've called us to co-labor with Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Oh, hallelujah. Whoo, glory, 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 glory to your name, Jesus. Glory to your name, Jesus. Thank you, Father. I just thank you, Lord, for a stillness on the babies, a quietness on the babies so they can be in here and not anyone be distracted in Jesus' name by your spirit. Holy Spirit can take charge of your baby. He can take charge of your mind so it doesn't wander to and fro. But you can stay hooked up with what the Holy Spirit is saying. You can stay hooked up with what God is doing in this place. We've got so much busyness in our lives now in these days. So much entertainment and so many things to distract us and allure us away from His presence. That almost each time people come into a church, they have to almost get resaved again because they've been out there in the stuff. It's sad. But I thank God for the majority in the abiding place because the word that goes forth from this podium, we have a people that are raising up to be valiant in God and refuse to allow themselves to be allured by the world. They won't let any of these dangling little pretty things draw them and allure their heart away from Him. Oh, Jesus. He is everything. And there's none like Him. He is everything. He must be your everything and your all in all, or He's nothing, because He hasn't captivated your heart. If He hasn't captivated your heart, then is He there? Is He in you if He hasn't captivated your heart? He may have been in you at one point, but you grew cold and away from Him. And you can only go so far with that, and then you find yourself backslidden. You know, if you're running a race and you're going forward in the race, stopping to take a break and running the other way for a little bit is not going to get you across the finish line. It's going backwards. And if you're going backwards, then that is backslidden. You're sliding back. Your heart's grown cold and away from God. That's when you think that you're full and you're in need of nothing. But God's mercy still says, I counsel you to buy of me gold tried in the fire. Isn't he good? Yes. A backslidden church, and God's still there counseling them to come. Because you think you're full, you're rich, you're in need of nothing, but you're naked and you're destitute. And you don't know it. But when, this is an example of knowing that fire's still burning. You just don't think you can worship him enough. You can't pray enough. You can't study his word enough. It's just not enough. You got to have more. You got to have more. Every day you got to have more. You go a few hours and you're, you know, busy working, but in that time you're even praying, but you're just like, it's not enough. I got to go and be alone with the one I love. I've got to instill myself before him. Another example is if when he speaks to you, you don't question, you just obey. Because you're captivated by the one you love. You just obey. And when you look in your word, in the word, and you look in his word, and it's mirroring to you Christ Jesus, and you're seeing Christ Jesus, and there's something there that is correcting you, you just obey. You just say, yes, Lord. And but basically more than that, you know, when I hear the word and it pierces my heart, and I can't sit in a service, I can't hear a preacher without the word piercing my heart unless he's an infidel. But even if he's an infidel and he quotes the scripture, I still hear. And I just continually just want to fall down on my knees and go, oh, God, make me like you, Lord. Make me like you, Lord. I don't want Geneva. I want you, Jesus. I don't want this life and the pleasures of this world. I want you, Jesus, and you alone. You know, many people come in and out of this place. We have an incoming and an outgoing. And that's because the fire's turned up. The word is preached. There's order in the church. There's correction in the church. And people come in and they hear it and they go, oh, it sounds good. But when the correction comes to them, they hang on to their life. Their life is so dear to them. Christ's life is not dear to them. Their life is so dear to them. So they must run and hide and mourn over their life and how dear it is to them. Because they must live their life. And how dare anyone bring correction, even though it just comes out of the Word of God. That's who God is. And I mean, very clearly, it says in the word, if he does not correct you, then you're a bastard. That means, in simple English, you are a fatherless child, and he is not your father. If you don't love his correction, if you can't receive correction from the church, then he's not your father. He ordained the church to bring that correction, to look into our lives, to see past where we can see. Because so many people sit in the church and they become deceived in some area of their life because they hang on to their life, and they don't know it. That's why it's deception. And they continue on with it again and again, and they can't even see it. And God will speak to them, but their heart becomes hardened because it's a continual thing that they've allowed in their life to where they don't even realize that it's going on. And then we've got the church that is to look and speak there and try to shake you loose from the deception by the Spirit if you will hear. We always want to be a hearer of the word and a doer. Not hearers only, but those that hear and receive it into their heart, receive it into their spirit, and live it. Live it. Walk it out. Oh, praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, I am just captivated by this, by several passages in the scripture. I've got so many different places the Lord has taken me in his word, and it's just so beautiful how he'll take you to a place in the word, and then you hear it from the pulpit, and you pick up a book, and it's all about that, or you know, the different things. You'll turn on somebody on YouTube, a preacher. You know, you don't have to watch the garbage that comes over the media if you're bored. And I don't know how anybody could be bored. There's too much to do. You can turn on a YouTube of a Holy Ghost preacher and let your spirit be fed. But you turn something like that on, and there's that same message that God's burning in your heart that he's saying to you, and he's just confirming it and confirming it. But I'm again captivated by a scripture that I've talked about. And I'm like, Lord, I minister on that all the time. But I'm captivated by this. I'm captivated by the love of God. I'm absolutely captivated by the love of God and what he has done. And I want to be captivated by the love of God and what he's done until I see him face to face. And we must continually be reminded of what he's done for us. And prepare ourselves to share what he's done for us. But in Mark chapter 12, verse 29, verse in 28, one of the scribes came to him, and he heard him reasoning together, and perceiving that he had answered the people before well, he said to him, "Which is the first commandment of all?" Okay, the number one commandment, the first one, and God put the first one there for a reason. The first commandment. The first commandment is, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one God. And you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind, and with all of your strength." This is the first commandment. And you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. That's with all your passion, all your attention, everything that's within you. It says all. It doesn't say some. It doesn't say give me some of your attention. It doesn't say work me into your schedule somewhere. It says all, A-L-L. It's our passionate pursuit to know the one who loved us and gave himself for us. Oh, Jesus. And the second one's likened to it, namely this: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There's none other commandment greater than this. No other commandment is greater. It all started with the love of God, a God that loves us so much. It all started right there with His love. And His first commandment is love. 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 Love Him first. Him first. Him first. Not you first. Him first. Not other people first. That's the second. Him first. Because we can even spend time in ministry, ministering to other people and not put Him first. And I'll tell you what will come out of that when He's not first and you're ministering to other people without putting Him first. What'll come out of that is your own abilities. Your own do good. And we look at this and we think, how can we love God with all of our heart, our soul, our mind, and our strength? It is impossible of ourselves. If we look at it in our ability, it is the law. It takes us back to the law. Because of ourselves, we cannot love God this passionately by ourselves, because we were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. That's what Adam and Eve did for us. It took that relationship that was created for us to have with God. It took that relationship. And I'll tell you, that spirit man on that day that they disobeyed God died. Deader than a doornail, dead. Died. The spirit man died at that moment that Adam and Eve disobeyed God one time. One time they disobeyed God. And that fellowship and that communion and that relationship and that knowing God died. A dead, dead, dead die. And every person that is born in sin and shaped in iniquity. Until they come to Jesus Christ, that spirit man is not made alive. It's dead. It's a stony heart. A heart written on the tables of stone that they tried to do by their ability, but they could not under the law. But thank God, we can look at Deuteronomy and start there, and we'll skip through a couple of places here. There's so many that we could go into in the Old Testament, but we'll just go a few. And I love this one. I love this scripture right here. And the Lord your God will circumcise your heart. The Lord your God will circumcise your heart. That means He's going to take that heart that's a commandment of your ability. While you're dead in your sin, He'll take that heart and He'll make it alive. He'll circumcise your heart and the heart of your seed to love the Lord your God with all of your heart. This is Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 6. And with all your soul, that you may live again, because you're dead. You're dead. But He will come and He will make you alive. And at that time that He comes and you're resurrected from the dead, it's not something that you try to think back on. It's something, it's an experience that you know happened. You know at that moment when you were dead in your sins and all of a sudden God came and He made you alive, you know that there was that transformation. You know that God took out that law and your ability and He put within you His spirit. That spirit man was made alive at that moment. And you understood as you repented and you realized, you know, because in the realization of that is you see yourself as a rotten sinner. It doesn't matter if you were a goody two-shoes or what you were. You see yourself as a rotten sinner. My mother was a good little girl, and you know, she didn't even steal a cookie out of the cookie jar. She was raised well. She had a fiery preaching grandpa. And she said the day when she was 10 years old that she sat in a service and she heard a sermon for the first time. It wasn't the first time she heard that sermon. She heard that sermon many times. But for the first time, she saw that she was a sinner in need of a Savior. And she felt so rotten, so miserable, and so in need that she came and she fell down and she said, "Oh God, forgive me. I'm a sinner and I'm in need of a Savior." And she cried out to Him, and her life was changed at that moment. See, so many people pray a diddly prayer, and then they go on and, you know, do what they're told. Okay, now I'm supposed to study the scripture. And they wrestle all the time because they can't do any of it. Because they don't have the ability to live it out. Because somebody told them, pray this prayer and you're going to go to heaven. Now study these scriptures and pray every day and be a good girl or a good boy. And so they try so hard. And they go to church regularly. And they want to go to heaven. But they never saw that they were a sinner. They never realized that they were in need of a Savior. And they must come to Him and fall down and humble themselves completely before Him. And repent and say, "Oh God, I'm a sinner. I'm evil. I'm wicked. And there's no hope for me outside of Your goodness and Your mercy. And I come to You, Father." And there's emotion in that. I've never seen anybody get genuinely born again without some emotion in it. Because you come to that destitute place of realizing that you are evil and you are wicked and you are a sinner. And you are in great need of a Savior. And that's why I hate trying to collect how many names you can get that have prayed a prayer, and then you verify them that once they pray this prayer, they're going to heaven, and you're sending them to hell. You're sending them to hell. You're sending them to hell. You want to labor with them to know if that's what it takes, or just simply you can cast the devil out of many of them. I thank God that we have a pastor that flows in the Holy Ghost. And people get set free in these meetings. Like the young lady that was sitting behind me a few weeks ago. And the Spirit of God came and offended that woman greatly. And a religious person would say, or other people would say, "Oh boy, that poor girl. He's letting her have it." But I tell you what, it's by the Spirit that the captive are set free. And the offense came, and it hit her. And she came to a place that she didn't think that her Catholicism may be the answer. And she sat as the Lord continued to offend her. And she wrestled with, "But I'm a good person, I'm a Catholic, and they told me I'm on my way to heaven. I did all of this. I was confirmed, I was baptized, I was told by everyone that I'm going to heaven." And she wrestled with that. And then she came up, and thank you, Jesus, the Holy Spirit got a hold of me and said, "Get after that girl." And I said, "Hi, how are you? Who are you? And now do you need Jesus?" "I don't know." I said, "You do." And I prayed, and she was confused. I prayed with her, and the demon that was in her manifested. And I prayed with her and waited on divine direction and cast that devil out of her. And she was able to be set free. And I'll tell you, people, the demon that binds most people, living on the inside of them, is the demon of unforgiveness. Unforgiveness. Out of all the demons I've cast out of people, that is the number one. I can't think of anything hardly I've ever cast out besides unforgiveness and hatred. They're all together. They move together. It grows deeper and more demons come alongside of it. It's what happens. Devil doesn't like to be by himself. He likes to draw more in. And he just keeps working on you until you allow more and more and more to come. And that's the number one. And it starts with strife. Look in James what the Bible says about strife. Bitter envy and strife. Lie not against the truth, because where there's bitter envy and strife, and that thing's a slippery little thing. And if you allow it in your life, hello, are you dead, buried, and raised up with Christ Jesus? Are you your defense or is God your defense? People think they've got to straighten things out for God. They're dead wrong. God wants you to walk humbly, and he wants you to walk in love. Oh, praise you, Jesus. But I tell you what, you know, and usually, and I'll just tell you something here, a little bit about casting out devils. Usually pain will hit their body. When I was working last time in Carlos Anaconda's tent, I got so frustrated because I couldn't get to everybody. And they were releasing people because they'd pray for them and they had a pain. And they would, you know, the pain would manifest in their body, and they're like, oh, well, I prayed for their back, and, you know, we're believing God will heal them. And so they went, and I'm like, dear Lord Jesus. And I went to the pain that's manifesting in them is the demon. And it's trying to distract you over here to praying for the pain. You got to cast the devil out, and the pain goes. So does that give you a clue? Pain and demon spirits. But pain will manifest usually in their body somewhere that they've never had pain before. And it'd be excruciating. One lady I cast the devil out of, her head felt like it was going to explode. And she was like, oh, God, help me. See, what's happening is there's a realization that there's something wrong. And that demon's trying to hang on. But God in his mercy is revealing to them their need of repentance. Now this lady that her head was about to explode, and I'll come back to the other girl in a minute, but her head was about to explode with pain, and she's just calling, oh mercy, God, help me, help me, help me, help me. And I got in there, and by the Spirit, the Lord showed me and took me down to the depths of where the sin was. And it was, she had an abortion many years ago. And she could not forgive herself, and she shoved it down and hid it way in the corner. Now, why I'm saying that she shoved it down is she was one of the best Sunday school teachers in that Pentecostal church. And the pastor, both of them, the husband and wife, were standing in front of me going, she's our best Sunday school teacher, and you're casting a demon out of her. And we know that this is impossible, that you can't have bitter and sweet water flowing out of the same vessel. You can't have a tree that is bearing good fruit and evil fruit at the same time. It's going to be one or the other. They understood that. And then here I am casting the devil out of her, their best Sunday school teacher. And we got down in there, and she would forgive herself for what she had done, and she repented of the murder. 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 It's not a blob. You just took something into your hands that doesn't belong to you. You may be the woman that carries that child, but that child belongs to God. Life comes from him. And yes, it's born in sin and shaped in iniquity, but God's going to give it an opportunity to come to him. And when she got set free, boy, when that pain went, and that's what happens. When you get set free, the pain goes. When the person gets set free, the pain goes. Was she glad to be liberated? And she said, I've hid that for so long. You know, it's important that we confess our sins. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. But repentance must come. Not a little prayer that somebody prays. Okay, God, forgive me my sins, but don't mean it. Lord Jesus, come to my heart. You have a great plan for me. Amen. Okay, now can you let me go so I can go on about what I'm doing and now I'm going to heaven? Because I run into these people. Oh yeah, I prayed that prayer before and I'm going to heaven and I'm a good person. I've ran into these people and it's a horrible thing. And you have to try to get past the damage that's done and bring the word of God to bring them over to get set free. But it's one good thing about being able to stir up the devil and get him gripping on him with some pain so you can cast that demon out. Because I tell you what, when they get in pain, they're ready for it to go. They're ready. And so you can dig down in there and get it. And so when that precious girl got delivered from that demon, she saw her need for a Savior. And she was free. And the change came. The change came. I was thinking about another man that I heard a preacher telling about. And he's a big burly guy, lived up in Alaska. And he comes into the church and sits into the church. And the preacher just like looked on him and just preached directly to him the whole message. And then he went down to him and he said, "Sir, what's troubling you? I've never seen somebody in such turmoil before in my life." And he says, "Well, I live way out in the wilderness. You have to take a plane to get there, or you ride horseback. And so I've never been to church. And I believe in God. I believe there's a God. I know there's a God. And I've heard somebody talk about Jesus before, but that's about it." And he said, "And I just got word from my doctor that I have 3 weeks to live." And so the preacher says, "Well, did you hear the message? Did you listen to the message?" And he said, "Yes, I listened to the message, and it was so simple a child could comprehend that. A child could understand it." And so he began to take him through the word. He says, "I fly out tomorrow," but he said, I'll tell you what, "I'll cancel my plane, and I'll stay here with you, and I'll take you through the word of God and show you what Jesus has done." And so they went through the word of God, and then they prayed, and then they went through the word of God, and then they prayed, and then they went through the word of God, and then they prayed some more. And they just continued on, and he continued to just show him Jesus and his need for the Savior and why. And he said to the guy, he goes, I want you to read John 3:16 one more time. And he said, "We've read that several times, at least 20, 30 times now. We've read it a lot." He goes, "Yeah, I hear the Lord say, read that one more time." And he went, "For God so loved the world." Oh, 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 I've been born again. Oh, he said, "Have you ever read this? Have you ever read, 'For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son'? He did it for me." The change, the regenerated heart, the man that comes to know God and be known of God. I was preaching to someone in Home Depot the other day. Of course, they went to church at some point in their life. They didn't confess to be in church at that point. But I said, "Do you know God? Do you know him?" No answer. "Boy, they'll tell you, yeah, I go to church, and yeah, I prayed that prayer." Do you know him? More importantly, does he know you? Because there's fruit if he does. You say you go to church, do you live it? Is it the fruit that's bore on your tree? Because when you're born of the Spirit, you live by the Spirit. And the fruit of the Spirit is not envy and strife and jealousy and lasciviousness and adultery and fornication. It does not desire that. Our heart desires him. That is the fruit. That is how to know that we're in him and he is in us. because we bear his fruit. We do not bear any other fruit but the fruit of the Spirit. And if we come to a place that we fall so back from God that we bear evil fruit, thank God we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. And he's faithful and he's just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But all of our fruit is to be in him. Are we not passionately pursuing him? We're careless with this great salvation that he's given us. We're being careless with what he's done for us. Corinthians 13 paints the picture so clearly. It's so clear. Love is the principal thing. And the first commandment, if we keep nothing else in the Word of God but the first commandment, all else will follow. It'll flow out of us like a river. But you can't stay in a relationship and live somewhere else. If you're married to someone and they live in another house in another state, that relationship is not going to work out too well. You have to spend time with that person to build a relationship. And that's why relationships go so wrong, is because people don't spend time with the Lord and they don't understand relationship. They can't comprehend relationship. The comprehension of relationship in our world today is divorce. If I don't like it, I'll get out. That's not covenant keeping. That's not coming to him. And who wants to be married to a man or a woman that continually commits adultery on you again and 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 again? You're going to think, did you walk to that altar and make a covenant with God that it was me and me alone and that there would be no other? It's the same with the Father. But yet people think that Christianity somehow can be dealt with carelessly, and we can continue on with our own life and allow sin to continually be in our life and be right with God, be in covenant, be in relationship with him. That's what he dealt with Israel all the time. But you remember, they had the tables of stone. Their spirit, their inner man, the heart of their man was stone, and they had to try to keep. And Paul, you know, lays it out so clearly in Romans chapter 7. The things that I would do because I knew God was right, and I comprehended those things with my mind, with my brain, with the understanding I had, not with God's understanding. Who shall deliver me? I thank God through Jesus Christ the Lord. Here they tried to keep it by their ability. And now we have the ability of the Spirit to walk out all that God's called us to walk out. There is babyhood where God is just merciful. There's babyhood. But when you have been a Christian so long that you have to part the whiskers to put in the bottle, it's time to grow up. It's way past time to grow up. God is a good and merciful God, but he has given you all that it takes to walk out this life more than a conqueror. That's what he paid for us to do, to be more than a conqueror, to walk in authority and power and dominion and take everything that Satan would do and put it under our feet and stop it, not to act it out. Who is your Father if you're acting it out, if you're living it? Who is your Father? There's some people in this place that have to come to grips with that. Who is your Father? Is God your Father? Then serve him. If Satan's your father and he's the one you obey, then go ahead and serve him. You say, I don't want to serve the devil. Well, you do. So why not realize it? Why not realize that you're on your way to hell and that you're in need of a Jesus? And then maybe you can repent and get right with God. Because if you're not hungry for His word and you're not hungry to be in His presence, if something's more important than Him to you, and it's your wife, your children, your job, whatever, your entertainment. That's what I find in Southern California people won't let go of, is their entertainment. Oh, got to have our entertainment. We don't have our entertainment. I was raised, you know, mostly in the South. And, you know, entertainment might be a coloring book. Good gracious sakes. Here, you got to go to Disneyland, Sea World, Magic Mountain, and make sure you learn to surf, ride a bike, go swimming, da-da-da-da, you know. And it's just all built around sensual, earthly, devilish things. It's fine to enjoy the great creation that God has given us, but is God first? Do you put those things as priority? Or is your job all about Jesus? Is your entertainment all about going out there and ministering to somebody? Who can I tell about Jesus? Do you go and get away with God on your camping trip? Is that what it's about, so you can grow closer to Him? Or is it this thing that's called, I got to have some me time? I got to have some God time personally. Because I don't like me. Me always blows it. And when you get in that place of I blew it, God's saying, you blew it, you blew it, you blew it. Come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. You know, the Sabbath is a rest in God all 7 days of the week. It's entering into His rest all 7 days of the week. To where you love Him and you don't have to take a day of me. You don't want to. Because you really see who me is. And it's not Him. We don't want earthly, sensual, devilish. We want Him. And we want people to come to know who He is. And that the old man has passed away. She's not bothering me. You can bring her up here to me and I'll hold her. Preach with her, and the glory of God will come on her. The anointing will increase. She'll get captivated by God. We'll never have to worry about the powers of darkness coming against her. That's my baby, so I can say that. That's my grandbaby. She's the youngest of my 10 grandbabies. Thank you, Jesus. And she's a good baby, and I command her to raise up and be a prophet of the Lord. And speak forth the word of God in Jesus' name. Responsibility of dad and mom and grandma and grandpa is going to go after it. Our nanny and papa are going to go after it and see her raised up to be mighty in Jesus. Oh, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for what you've done. You know, the Lord woke me up with some things this morning, and I don't normally read anything. But I'm feeling it right now. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You know, and I just started to say this a few minutes ago, a lot of people have head knowledge of God. And I touched on it just a little bit. A lot of people have a head knowledge of God. They say a prayer, they said a prayer, and they want to go to heaven. Everybody wants to go to heaven, but they want to go to heaven their way. And there's all kinds of another gospel out there. They want to go to heaven their way. And so that's why there's another Jesus and another gospel. And because the church isn't valiant in the United States of America anymore, we've got the Buddhist temples raising up and that and the other and all kinds of religions, and people that should be Christians are flocking to it. But you know what? You know, they allow you to practice, you know, they have yoga exercise brought into a lot of the churches today. It stinks. I said, I'm having nothing to do with Eastern religion. A doctor said to me one time, well, you should do yoga. I said, I'll have nothing to do with Eastern religion. There is no other God besides him, and I will not practice any of their religion. I'll have nothing to do with it. I'll have no part of it. And I tell you what, you can ask some people that's around me close. I get aggro about that. And I will yell at you. Because I know people that started out with yoga exercise and then the next 15 years of their life was given over to Buddhism because they saw a light. Satan can appear as an angel of light. And I tell you what, if your heart's sensitive to God, you're not going to mess with stuff like that. So get sensitive to God. Seek him. Pray about everything you do. Pray about it. I pray about my parking spaces. Especially if I'm in a hurry, I pray about everything. What kind of toothpaste to buy? God will lead you and guide you and direct you into everything. He'll tell you what grocery store to go to. But anyway, people sit around with a bunch of head knowledge. They came to God, and they decided to live their life in sin. But they come to church all the time, and they're so full of head knowledge of God. They're theologians, and their heart's not anywhere near God. They're hearers, but they're not doers because it's impossible for them to be a doer, but they can look like it on the outside. But I tell you what, God can reveal that thing, and the demons will start manifesting. So you don't want to just hear everybody that's got something to say about God. You want to be careful to what you listen to because you don't want the impartation of their head knowledge. You want to see somebody moving and flowing in the Holy Ghost. You want to know that the works of the Spirit are there. Like my friend John, he said, I'm not educated by this world's standards, but I know him who is able. He said, I don't speak eloquently, but I flow in the Holy Ghost. And there's a whole lot more he said, but I won't get into all of that right now. But, you know, he had his PhD and his master's. And anyway, thank you, Jesus. It doesn't matter how much we know, but it matters. It matters who we are in Christ Jesus and how much we know him and that he knows us and that proof is there. And the fruit is not the miracles. That's Jesus showing up and doing what he does when we preach the word by the Spirit. The fruit is love, starting with love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, meekness. And that reminds me, I was going into Corinthians chapter 13, 1 Corinthians chapter 13. You can prophesy. You can understand all. You can have all kinds of knowledge. You can give all of your goods to feed the poor. All of them. Boy, you look so good. You gave everything away except the shirt on your back. And if somebody needs that, I'll give that too. You can give your body to be burned. But if you don't know him, and the proof is you don't love him, it profits you zero. He doesn't care about the works of man's ability. He cares about the fruit being in your life, and number one, do you love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength? Would you get so aggro against sin that you would resist it to the point of blood, standing against it, because you hate everything that God hates? See, that comes with a new nature. The fear of the Lord comes with a new nature. The fear of the Lord hates evil, pride, arrogancy, and the evil way. Because we've been given the divine nature at that new birth when our spirit is made alive. We've been given the new nature. But we must carefully tend to that new nature. And that's what I'm just preaching right here, what I've got written. Is your life manifesting the fruit of the Spirit? Is it inside of you, living, walking it out? The fruit that automatically begins to be on your tree, and the hatred for sin that is formed in you, formed in your spirit man, formed in your heart, when that spirit man becomes alive. Because realize, until that spirit man comes alive, their spirit is dead. There's a bunch of dead people walking around. Adam and Eve, Satan told them they wouldn't die. That was true. They wouldn't die physically, but they would die spiritually for eternity unless they repented and came to God. And that's every man until that spirit's made alive. And if you're a Holy Ghost person, you can be around a person that's talking out of a great theologian, talking out of their head knowledge with God, and you can, boom, go, there's no life there at all. They can say it. They have all the words down. I've been around a lot of people like that. They'll preach to people all the time. And it's all about making them look good while they're slipping over here in sin, living in sin, and liking sin and loving sin. If you love sin, you need to repent and realize that you're in need of a Savior. If you love it, I'm not talking about if you slip into it, but I'm talking about if you continually go back to it, go back to it, go back to it. You need to get down on your knees, you need to fast, you need to pray, you need to seek God until you completely put that thing to death by the Spirit, not your ability. But if you've come to God and you go back into sin and you keep doing that same thing over, that bondage, you know, a lot of times it'll be something passed down from your parents. It'd be something that your parents allowed in their life and grandparents, and it's passed down through generations, and it needs to be broken off of your life if you're going back to it. I tell you, when we come to God and we confess our sins, we repent of our sins, He cleanses us, He makes us whole. But if you go back to the weak and beggarly elements of this world and you continually go back to it, that thing will get a hold of you. And it will grip you again. And Christ will need to be formed in you again. Because that demon will come live on the inside of you. Because you'll be in a place where you can't help it. You'll find that you can't help it. You continually find yourself there. It's a demon from hell. And you want deliverance. I tell you what, your soul is too precious to sit around and play with it. You don't know how much time you have. And your soul is too precious. How many here want to go to prison and live there for the rest of your life? Be on death row. Until you're on death row, you go to prison, you stay there until you die. Well, who wants to go to the prison of hell that you can never get out of? There's no hope. There's no hope for parole. We cannot be careless. We want to passionately pursue Him. We don't even want to be like the church of Ephesus, where Jesus came and said, I see all the good things you do and they're all spot on, but you have left your first love. This one thing I have against you, and you better repent, He said, and do your first works over. He didn't say, you're doing everything else so right that, you know, we're going to work this out with you and we're going to get through it and I'm going to walk you out the next 20 years and you're going to get it down. He said, you better repent and do your first works over. Fall in love with the Almighty and let Him take you over into this realm of glory. Live in heaven and earth today. Why live in the torture of hell? Why live in the torture of Satan ruling and reigning over your life and you feeling miserable about it? All the time. The people that feel the most miserable are backsliders, because they know that they can be right with God, but they're living in sin. Why be miserable when you can live in heaven today on earth? That no matter what they do to your body, no matter what comes your way, no matter what's taken from you, it cannot take this fellowship and this relationship with the Almighty God that is going to be for eternity. That's going to take you up into the realms of glory that you will live in forever and ever and ever. Why play around in the devil's camp and chance your eternity? Because who knows? The trumpet could sound, or a car could hit you and you could die instantly. Who knows? We don't know what time we have. So we want to passionately pursue him and his will and his purpose and his plan for our life. Everybody stand with me. And anyone that God has touched, this isn't a time to go to the bathroom. This is a time to focus on your eternity. And as you stand here, any of you that have played around in the devil's camp, you want to cry out to God right now to forgive you. And I'm not talking about people that slipped into something. I'm talking about people that are doing it, allowing it again, and they fall back into it again and again. You want to make it right with God once and for all. And you need to do it now. Now. You don't have to come forward. It's good for you to come forward. Because I tell you what, the high and lofty one, the one that inhabits eternity, dwells with him that's of a broken and a contrite spirit. Amen. That will take pride and cast it down. Yes. And say it doesn't matter what people think. Yes. It matters what Jesus thinks. Amen. About me. Yes. And I'll walk humbly. Yes. But I tell you what happens most of the time. The people that are continually, oh God, I just want to be closer to you. God, I want more of you. They're the ones that will come and repent because they hear a message like this and they're just, they're all in. And the ones that are walking just barely with God, they're dangling on a string that could be broken at any time. They've got so much pride, they sit in their seat. And they don't come running to him. We want to be confident in our salvation. But we want to also know that we're not backslidden. That we're not a sinner. That we're not away from God. That he is first. And if he's not first, make him first right now. And I tell you, if you've had continual sin in an area, you probably need to get the devil cast out of you. Either that or repent. Get on your face before God, cry, and turn from your wicked ways. And if you can't get victory, we'll take you down the path of getting you delivered. And I tell you, it might be embarrassing, but who cares? I'd rather know that I know him. But we'll get that thing dealt with and we'll get it yanked out. But you don't want to return to it ever again. You don't want to return. If you're forced to return, there you very well may be demon-possessed. If you are just gripped by something to where you cannot help yourself and you return to it, if it simply is not liking people, which is hatred, it's either you love them or you hate them. We want to say not don't like, because it sounds better. But if you continually have problems with relationship, look back at your mama. Look at your mama. Look at your daddy. Did they have that? Was it broken relationship all the time? Did they, you know, have a friend for a short time and then dislike them? And a lot of times is you want to be better than them and look better than them. It's sad, 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 sad. We want to dwell. We want to dwell with him. He dwells with the broken and the contrite. I want to be there. If it's bowing down to my face, on my face on the ground, and you know, when I see that, what I literally see in my mind's eye is I see bowing low, and then that water that comes from the throne of God coming and just filling my mouth as I lay prostrate before him, and that river of living water just coming filling me up. Woo! Glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody in this place that wants prayer for anything, because I tell you the healing anointing is here, because he promised, he said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel, and these signs shall follow, and they're here. And if there's anybody sick, if anybody suddenly got pain, you want to come. And if there's anyone sick, We want to pray for you. We want to see it broken off of you. In Jesus' name. Sickness has no hold on me because I'm living in heavenly places. By His stripes I'm free, you see. We're living in heavenly places. And you need to say it to yourself again and again. The power of sin was broken off of me at Calvary. The power of sickness and disease was broken off of me. He bore those stripes in His back to set me free, and it's mine, and Satan can't have me. Not one part of my body. I won't yield my body to him. I won't yield my spirit. I won't yield my eternity to anyone but the Almighty. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Now, you are not dismissed. All of those that stay in their seat that know him can press in and pray that people are healed, set free, and delivered. You press in with the anointing God's given you. Because when we press in together, there's power, there's authority in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Santa. Yelena mashukara. Selena masita. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. He's given us the oil of joy for sadness and sorrow. The garment of praise, hallelujah, for heaviness. And when we come to Him as His servants and we ask Him to do something, we want to come to Him believing He's going to do it. And that's a place to come rejoicing. My God is going to meet all my needs. He's going to answer everything for me. We don't have to come in sadness and sorrow, because that is in the realm of doubt and unbelief. We come in joy and rejoicing, knowing in whom we have believed, and that He is able. 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 In Jesus' name, the oil of joy, the oil of joy, the oil of joy, the garment of praise. Praise your way right out of the situation in Jesus' name.
I just want to become blameless 24/7, like without any little slip-ups, not just what I do.
We all do, and it's a walking it out.
And my thoughts too.
Yeah. So, what? You cast down every thought that would exalt itself against the knowledge of God.
Okay.
You bring in captivity every thought into the obedience of Christ. And so a thought comes, you go to the Word. You begin to pray, Jesus, right now, your strength by the Holy Spirit. Yes. Start praying in the Holy Ghost and you go to the Word. And you start reciting the Word. And instead of going to the thought, you recite the Word.
Okay.
But you're in a process of learning how to walk with God.
Okay.
You're not like one of those Christians that sat in the church for 30 years and now we're parting the whiskers to put the bottle in and just trying to give you some milk. You're learning what Christ has formed in you. He's formed it in you, because I see it. I see that Christ has formed in you, and I confirm that.
Yes.
Now you're learning to walk with Him, and you're going to passionately pursue
Amen.
Him.
Amen.
And that's it right there.
Amen.
Now you obey the Word. Bring every thought into captivity unto Christ. And hallelujah, if we sin, we have an advocate with Jesus Christ the righteous. Thank you, Father. I write unto you, little children, that you sin not. But if you do, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. You're learning how to not to by the Spirit that He's put within you and the fear of the Lord that is put on the inside of you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Yeah, I told you the hungry people would be the ones that came up here. More, Jesus. More, Lord. More, Lord. In Jesus' name. Yes, ma'am. Do you know that He's given you a new heart and a new spirit, that He's put His Spirit on the inside of you and you're made alive in Him? Do you know that you are a sinner outside of Him and you're in need of repentance and you must call upon the name of the Lord to receive that?
Yeah, I do that.
You do that?
Every day.
Every day? Every day you call unto the Lord and you say, Father, forgive me. Well, God wants to take you past, Father, forgive me. And He wants to put His new heart and a new spirit within you. That you can walk with Him. That you can know Him. And that you know that you know Him and He knows you. By the Spirit that He places within you. Because that's the fruit of your life. You learn how to walk that out. That glorious relationship. That glorious fellowship. Father, we just thank you right now that we break off every lying demon of hell, every power of darkness. What is your name?
Angie.
Angie. Every lie of the enemy, every power of darkness, everything of the past is broken in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Take a hold of her. In the name of Jesus. Take a hold of her, Chris. In the name of Jesus. She walks out of it because she's afraid. Take a hold of her. Hold on to her. Okay. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Satan, I break your power. 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 I break your power over this woman in Jesus' name.